lot of good about learning, so much fun to honor all graduates. And at the earlier service, we honored Westwood College and Vocational School and Graduate School grads. And so that was fun to see high school students at this service. Today we're going to wrap up the series that we've been working on from the Book of Acts called I Will Build My Church. Next week, as you heard Pastor Noah, we're going to celebrate the PDL students, first of Tuesday. And Pastor Noah is going to preach his first time ever Sunday morning sermon. So y'all be remembering to pray for him as he is working on that. He'll be just a tiny bit nervous, probably not very much, but that'd be great. Also, I want to say thank you to Pastor Burnett for jumping in and preaching last Sunday. Great message. And Mabel, Michelle, and I, and our whole family, to go to Spokane for the weekend, visit Michelle's mother, and only remaining talent. So, that was a wonderful time for us, and we're very thankful for that chance. It's very fitting that we end this series with a passage that actually comes from the Gospel of Matthew. And I say that because it is in the Gospel of Matthew that we read this statement by Jesus: I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. I want you to think about that statement for a minute. That means that the church is on a mission to raise hell, right? The gates of hell shall not prevail against the power of Jesus that is at work in the church. In other words, we get to be part of a great big rescue mission. What God is doing to disarm the powers of this world, the dark spiritual powers, the powers of the enemy Satan, the powers associated with us. And what does Satan do? How does he destroy us? By enslavement to sin. We get to be a part of bringing the message to the world in Jesus Christ that sets human beings free. So it's awesome. It's wonderful. The passage we're looking at today contains what you've all heard referred to as the Great Commission. Through Jesus telling his disciples what the rest of their life is going to look like, what they're going to be doing in serving him. Now, this encounter with Jesus is after his resurrection. It's back in Galilee, where he originally came from, where the disciples came from. He will speak to them again one more time in Jerusalem at the festival of Pentecost, what we refer to as the birthday of the church. And guess what? Today is the day of Pentecost. Did you know that? The day when we celebrate the beginnings of the church. We've got our Pentecost banner to remind us about what a wonderful day this is. There are three important aspects to what Jesus said in Galilee on this occasion that I want to call attention to this morning. And I just want to say, they are every bit as relevant for our lives today as they were when Jesus spoke these words. Here's the first one. He made a great plan. Jesus made a great plan. Jesus said something about himself here he had never said before. Something big. Something grandiose. You know, it's been said that Jesus was either everything he claimed to be, or he suffered from delusions of grandeur, right? Those are your only two choices. Either he was everything he claimed to be, or he was suffering from some delusions about who he was, based on what we read in the Scripture. Listen to what he said. I have been given all authority in heaven and on earth. Now, please think about those words. All authority. Not some authority, not partial authority, not authority over one part of the world. All authority in heaven and on earth. And what is that? That's the spiritual realm. That's the place where God dwells as spirit. That's the capital city, if you will, of the kingdom of God. But not just heaven that's off in the distance somewhere, that's part of some future reality. He also said on earth. So just add all the was Donald Trump and Vladimir Putin and Justin Trudeau and Xi Jinping of China and Angela Merkel and Theresa May. And guess what? It doesn't come anywhere close to the apostle Jesus. Amen? Amen. That's the truth. That's God's truth. Jesus' authority as Son of God exceeds all of the authority anybody has been given on the face of this earth. See, Jesus was making an enormous claim, wasn't he? And he'd already backed it up in his resurrection. I mean, that was unprecedented. This is not the boast of a braggart. You see, what is said here is actually the foundation for everything he's going to tell his disciples about their future and their lives. Folks, I just want to say this. When we come up against something in life that seems overwhelming, something that seems too big for us, something that seems too complex, could we please remember that the one who has promised to be with us, to never leave us nor forsake us, has all authority? He has the authority to make it go away. He has the authority to be present with us in the midst of it, to walk us through it, to bring us victory because of it, to accomplish something wonderful in our lives. He has all authority. That's the one we turn to help in the midst of our struggles and our hardships. The one who has all authority in heaven and on earth. Here's the next one. He gave a great charge. Now, it has to go with the word charge here because we always hear the word commission, great commission. Sometimes we hear things too many times. It goes in one way, not the other. This is really a challenge. This is what he told them they were going to be doing with the rest of their lives. Maybe we get a little different perspective when we think of it this way. There are really four parts to this. We read it together already. Let's take a look. The first part of the instruction was to go into the world. Now, I'm going to tell you my Greek words, actually, the way they're construed, have ongoing significance. I'm probably more accurate to the translator. As you are going into the world, it's how you are going into the world. By doing, it's not a matter of willing you go into the world. It's what will we do? If you have a place, you will be going into the world. What that means is a person or across the street. We are going places as part of our normal day-to-day life. Those are all the fact that some have a special call from God to go to a business. We usually refer to them as missionaries, right? And the fact is, the Carpenter church reconnected with the support of the missionaries. I mean, we believe in the mission of America. We believe that we're supposed to be a sending church. We're supposed to send people in the world to serve God. That's still all we need to have for our world. For us. And yet, the story tells us one extent of attention that we all do missionaries in the places that we go as normal lives. So think of yourself that way. Whatever what is the cost, wherever you go in your day to day life, make a consistent, concerted witness for Christ. It doesn't mean that. That does mean you have to know that you're a follower of Christ and what it looks like in your life and what that means to you. And then it says, make disciples of all nations. What the word nations is the word ethnic. And it's too much in which we get up on ethnic. Really means it's not talking here about nations as political and geographical entities. He's talking about all peoples, all countries, everywhere. What's significant here is this universal expansion of Christ's mission to reach the world. If we think back on this ministry of Jesus himself, we remember that he limited himself, didn't he? To the nation of Israel, right? And occasionally he disappeared. He came from one who was meant for Israel, but he was part of his ministry, went to the Jews, and he said, I came to the last group of Israel. But now, and this new church has got to be so good. You know what? It's a different story with this good news. We are called to work the whole world with the good news. And that's because it's intended for everyone, because God is intent on redeeming the whole planet and the whole world. No person on earth is an exception. It is the man. That's what God wants to do. In the last 17 Hebrews, there is a standing young pastor who felt called to listen to him. He felt called to go to India. And next year, his local Baptist conference board, and he asked them to send him to India for the future. His name is William Kelly. And you know what I can say to him? The king of the world literally put on the back of his coat and said, young man, sit down. When God wants the heathen converted, he will take us up. But God was going to do it without missionaries. Well, William told him to take down the heathen. He went back to prove to this God that God was sending missionaries all around the world, and they were meeting this success. People were coming to this. William Carey went to India, spent the next 41 years of his life, and never returned to India. He is known today as the father of the modern missionary movement, because of the influence he had on other missionaries, hundreds of missionaries, to follow after. And interestingly, when he preached the good news in India and somebody came to Christ, he told them that one of the things they had to do was leave the caste system behind. He had no place in the kingdom of God. You know what else he did? He lived his life to be in the kingdom of God. He encouraged the Indian independence movement. You remember the Indian Church? It's part of the British Empire. You see, now, God wants India to be an economic center to study in the 1960s. That word disciples, what do you mean? He's the learner. He's taught. He's not talking about something that is one moment in time mentioned in the Bible. We're talking about becoming a disciple. We're talking about something that lasts for a whole lifetime. It stretches out. We know that we are all continually being shaped into a more Christ-like person. That God's work in our lives is to make us the very best and most wonderful version of ourselves. And we can make it more by shaping and molding us after the example of Christ. Somebody said in the definition, we move from the preaching of Jesus to preaching Jesus. Is it a point? Jesus is the message. To follow him is the invitation. To make a commitment to him is the entry into discipleship. Whenever we start, God spends the rest of our lives forming us and shaping us and molding us to be more like Christ. That's what I'm going to work on. Next, he says, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. You will notice the emphasis on God is manifesting himself in three persons, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Then all the way back to the lips of Jesus. baptism, as you probably went back to the beginning of our faith in following Christ. The water represents cleansing from sin, but even beyond the old way, the embracing of a whole new way. For some new way, by our own standards, without any awareness of concern for God, a radical shift. For those who have grown up in Christian life, the lifestyle might not be so radical. They've gotten used to Christian values. But that is still a new collective commitment. No one can do that for you. Into this dry, pagan week, sending Jewish disciples to proclaim this new world. When people came forward to baptism, they were saying, I'm done with my old life. I'm done with what I used to do. I am stuck in all of this place. And Jesus, it's a powerful statement. And the last part of it is to teach these new disciples to obey for all the commands I have given them. Which is to say, it's not just that there is no structure to what's happening to us. It's not as if there were no avenues to saving it, or expectations to be happy. It's certainly not a legal code. I do not have a legal code. But there are some rights and wrongs, some good deeds to embrace, some sins to avoid. See, there was a lifestyle following Christ that came with great freedom and great responsibility. Never one without the other. Freedom and responsibility. What needed to be obeyed were the commands of Christ. That means all the teachings of Jesus. And it became the power of the disciples to spell that out for people, to make it clear. Remember, when the early church got started, we read that one question is here to ask themselves to reflect.
And then Jesus said, the word Hebrew Matthias, the one that God promised to the Hebrew people for centuries. He talked about Jesus' death and Jesus' resurrection. He called upon crowds to repent from their sins and to find forgiveness in Jesus. And we look at that message and the others we look about, and we see all of us elements of the Christian message to this day. And we know that the fact is to believe. Do your own things. And begin to follow him. It was a glorious birth, and it was truly a sign of greater things yet to come in our future. Here we are, 21 centuries later, and it's still God, it's still happening, and that is because of the presence of the Holy Spirit when the message is proclaimed. And all the things. First, with that, we're after working on this day, too, that if you never had the courage to stand and to speak such a message, and you're after working on this day, nobody would have believed in it, and that would have been sad on their hands. But there's a time when it comes that nobody, none of us can make a decision to call it God without God, with all his spirit, without God's spirit working on our hearts, witnessing to us. Tugging at us, this is what you need to do. You need to call it from here. Here's the Apostle Paul's words in 1 Corinthians 12, 23. No one can serve Jesus as Lord except by the Holy Spirit. So you have to have help. You think we cannot get there by the Holy Spirit. The disciples have no supernatural power of their own to do what God was calling them to do what Jesus was sending them to do. Standing the church and keeping it going in the first century and all the following centuries required the powerful presence of Christ in the person of the Holy Spirit. And you know that everybody who has come to Christ to walk with Christ from there is like some of those Holy Spirit moments where you can remember something specific and powerful God if there's anybody here today who has never welcomed Christ in your heart and life, and made that commitment to follow his Lord, let me give you the opportunity to do that, okay? I'll pray a prayer during the larger prayer. If you'll just pray that prayer with me, if you've never taken that first step with Christ, if you've never made that commitment to me, just believe that this is the day God wants you to do that, that God really is speaking in your heart and life, okay? Let's pray that. It's a vision for all of us to realize that in Christ you did something amazing, something unlike anything this world has ever seen. You set us free from sin, from the power of sin to control us, to dominate us, to condemn us, to know. To a life of misery apart from the words of the King. And then you begin to work on the Lord to make us the very best version of us, the version of us you had in mind the day we came into this world. Making each one of us different and distinct, and yet reaching the place of who we want us to be only through Christ's presence. And the faithfulness is so great, it just keeps on going. And we will keep on going. For that day when you call us in, and your day is to be true. You're here this morning, and you have taken that first step. I know God's going to do that for you. First step is trusting Jesus Christ in us. recommend him into your heart, accepting the gift of forgiveness that he truly wants to give you. Turn around to Jesus. Give me that first step or I'm not even here. Take it from there. Set me free from the past. I don't need to form me life. The absolute best. The last and the first of this is the best of you in the future. Even in the chains of the earth and the human and the presence of God. Christ speaking to you this evening. This is not just a lot of you. Go on. Thank you.